Exercise physiology is both the study of an acute response but also chronic adaptations to the human body under many different physical exercise conditions. A lot of times when people hear sports medicine, sports science, exercise physiology, they think of elite athletes, the lung capacity of Lance Armstrong. Okay. That does get a lot of publicity, but exercise physiology is about a lot more than just elite athletes and performance.
I've had a really awesome week here at Pepperdine. I had the week off of school, and I had been talking to some of the sports med faculty here, kind of linked up with them because they've been working with CrossFit a little bit. And so I just had the awesome opportunity to spend my vacation here and got to kind of hang out and see what they're doing with their research and their plans. And they've also been really helpful in mentoring me and helping me figure out where I want to go as I'm going through medical school and thinking about my own research.
The first time I did Fran with a barbell and some bumper plates out on an alumni field, it took me, I'm not sure if I finished, but it took me between 15 and 18 minutes. And I was sort of whimpering to my consigliere, Scott, like, is it supposed to hurt this much?
Mostly I had been talking to some people in CrossFit, Dr. Will Wright, and he kind of, just over the past year, as I've been thinking about my own research, and he kind of connected me with everyone here at Pepperdine because they've been starting to work with CrossFit a little bit too. So,
a common measurement in exercise physiology is the measurement of the volume of oxygen consumed during exercise. So essentially what we do is measure the volume of oxygen consumed and the carbon dioxide exchanged or output. By looking at a ratio of those two gases, we can tell a lot about the energy usage of the body.
CO2 is one of the end products of energy metabolism. So as you are producing energy to power muscular work, one of the byproducts of that energy production is CO2. The end product of all energy metabolism is CO2 and water production. So we're going to be monitoring that.
The doctors McCray, Holden and Priscilla, were two people that I asked. I wanted their opinion about me opening a CrossFit gym in Malibu and what they thought. And Holden gave me two resounding thumbs up, being CrossFit is not one of these fly-by-night exercise programs that in a couple of years we won't hear about it anymore. In fact, it's growing because it works. It's results-based. People train, they get fitter. Elite athletes train, they get fitter. To my knowledge, there's not another type of fitness program that offers a results-based, something that you can actually tangibly measure results over time. We're not necessarily testing changes in body fat, although we know changes in body fat occur. We're not necessarily measuring things like cholesterol changes due to exercise, or changes in diabetics. There is a diabetic in this room who over the last 2 months has gone off diabetes medication as a result of diet and exercise changes. There we go.
We have now these portable units. We have one of those units with us today, and we're going to put that unit on a couple of our athletes. Same idea, it's just not attached to a big cart. So the athlete essentially wears around on their back or on their chest or on their waist this metabolic unit. They have a mask fit to their face, no more nose pinching, and a two-way breathing valve.
From my understanding, it's a very sort of unique opportunity for the sports med department here to look at what's physiologically going on with us while we're doing Fran, while we're doing CrossFit workouts, which I don't think has been done before, and to share that with all the sports med students here to sort of show them what CrossFit is all about, and kind of give them a CrossFit 101, but also collect some data and use that to, you know, educate the students and kind of start this research on what CrossFit is.
2, 1,
go, Julie. 1.
Studying exercise can lend itself to disease prevention and disease treatment. So we study the effects of exercise on pathology. Pathology is disease or disorder in the body. We study the effects of exercise on that disease or disorder and mechanisms by which exercise can help reduce, eliminate, or prevent diseases.
I really love their approach to research here and how much they really want their research to affect people and to not have research be published in a paper that's filed away somewhere and no one reads it. I think that's really important in translating that research to medical care and to general practice, so it really helps people and improves people's lives.
What's there, Julie?
Last one.
Come on.
Last
one.
Here we go.
I think it's something that will allow us to have these discussions about what CrossFit is and what is physiologically going on in the research world, because it's harder to have those discussions without data and without seeing exactly what's going on and learning. I mean, CrossFit is just this really unique way of exercising and learning what's actually going on and what, you know, what we might be capable of doing in the future. It's really exciting. So I think it's an avenue to sort of start quantifying and start looking at what exactly is going on in CrossFit workouts and sort of open that door to future research and future observations. This week has helped me really focus in on what I really care about and what I want, sort of my where I want my path to go with my own research and with my education. So sort of making decisions as they come up over the next few years of school, aligning with that goal. And kind of helping me to unite, you know, my passions for CrossFit and for medicine together. So it's been a really awesome just sort of combination of everything that this week has just been a sort of a culmination of, you know, my passion for medicine, my passion for CrossFit and working out, and sort of seeing where that might take me in the future.
Hey, come on.
Seven. Good job, Julie.
Last
good
one,
job.
Last one, Julie.
Good pace.
So if you look out on the right, on the black line over on the right-hand graph there, it's kind of leveled off just below 190 for those 2 minutes. Okay, pretty high. Okay, it's probably right at her max or close to her maximum. The dashed line you see in red along here, that's her predicted maximum for her age and her gender. And you can see clearly she's working well above that, right? So clearly she's got a capacity well beyond what we would expect. This line that you see tracking along here, that's the respiratory quotient or respiratory exchange ratio. As I said, generally, and I can't see this, generally most of us at rest are somewhere around 0.8, okay, which would indicate mostly fat providing energy to our bodies. When we get up around 1, that would be 100% carbohydrate that we're using, no fat. And you can see, you know, early on, and then she went up, and you can see she's right above 1. So she's driving, most of her energy has been driven by stored glycogen or blood glucose, predominantly. Very little fat is being used. Now, in recovery, as she's recovering from this, you get a switch over. So probably about 85 to 90% of her energy being used right now in recovery is coming from fat metabolism, which is why elite athletes have very little body fat on them. Because when they train like this for 2 or 3 hours a day, day after day, during this recovery period where your metabolism's still elevated, you have this very, very high rate of fat use. Okay, so we're at rest. Most of us are using about 60% of our energy is being derived from fat. When you recover after exercise, about 85 to 90% of that elevated metabolism is being derived from fat. When you generate these very high oxygen uptake rates during exercise, your metabolism stays elevated for longer. So if I do a low intensity training session, I might get 20 minutes of elevated metabolism afterwards. I do one of these training sessions, or not this particular workout, but let's say I train for 15 to 20 minutes at a high intensity, I might get 2 hours of elevated metabolism. And that 2 hours will be mostly fat that's supplying the energy. And if I do that for a month, 3 months, 6 months, a year, 2 years, then my body looks a little bit different compared to someone who does the so-called fat burning zone exercise.